Well, happy homecoming and welcome to worship. It has been 65 years of Milford Hills United Methodist Church in ministry here in this community, and we are pleased that you are watching this and celebrating with us wherever you find yourself today. But we're glad that you're here. There are some announcements today. One is that next week things change again. In a year full of change, we are changing something as well. We are slowly improving our worship, and we are going back to Sunday worship online, but it'll be live streaming. So we won't be meeting with Zoom to watch on together on YouTube, or you won't be able to get it other times. You'll have to go to milfordhillsumc.org/worship by 10 o'clock, and you can watch the live stream there. As we move forward, hopefully there'll be some other areas that we can improve on, but for right now, starting next week, you need to go to milfordhillsumc.org/worship so that you can watch as we live stream. And just so you can remember, here's a quick little video.
Just a small town church, empty in a COVID world. Doors are closed and worship is online.
Brady Bunch on Zoom, pastors preaching in an empty room. Doors are closed and worship is online. Singing heads, people watch from their beds.
Nothing's normal, and this year's going on and on and on and on. Facebook, YouTube, pre-recording on Zoom. Nothing is like it was before. Normal return, make it like it was before, won't happen anytime soon.
Now, because we are going to live stream, that means some other things are changing. Blake's hours are changing. She won't be in the office every Thursday. She's actually going to be there every Monday because we'll be moving our mailings from Thursday to Monday. And so those worship mailings we've been sending out, we'll actually send it out after Sunday. So please take note of that. I want to thank everyone who has helped out with Messy Church. That video went live last Sunday, and we've had 52 views, which is wonderful as we start that new type of ministry as well. But we are glad that you're here. We have a special preacher today. Our district superintendent, Reverend Laura Auten, is going to be bringing us the sermon later on today. And so we're grateful that she's recorded a sermon and is providing that for us to use as we celebrate our 65th year together. And we have a mission here at Milford Hills United Methodist Church, which is the driving force behind what we do. And our mission here is to love, serve, and live as Christ. And that begins here in worship. So let us open up worship and prayer. Let us pray. Loving God, we come this day to worship with so many things on our hearts and minds. We are drawn away by problems and cares, so heal our spirits, open our hearts, and help us be your disciples. Amen.
Christ my King, through eternal ages let his praises ring. Glory in the highest I will shout and sing, standing on the promises of God. Standing on the promises, standing on the promises, standing on the promises of God my Savior. Standing on the promises, standing on the promises. Standing on the promises of God, standing on the promises that cannot fail. When the howling storms of doubt and fear assail, by the living word of God I shall prevail. Standing on the promises of God, standing on the promises, standing on the promises, standing on the promises of God.
We come to a time of prayer in our service today, and this week we want to remember Ann Polson, Ray and June Scott, Noelle Burns, Steve Surratt, Doug Jones, Mary Kay Zygmunt, the family of Tom Halley, Ron Turbeville, and Ann Sidney. And if there are any others that you would like to lift up this week, as I move down to the prayer rail, you're welcome to do that. Let us pray. Holy Lord, it's always good to go home. We are grateful that our final home is in you, for that is where our hearts are. But in the meantime, it's wonderful to return to our earthly roots and to celebrate the sense of joy and familiarity that we feel when we go there. It reminds us that the whole earth is yours and that wherever we go, we are still part of a larger family. We thank you for the things about home that remain comfortable to us. The good people we knew, the memories that are rekindled when we returned, the places where we once walked and sat and studied, the stores where we shopped, the church where they sing the old songs and pray real prayers and declare the gospel the way they always did. And we thank you for what those returning bring to us at home, a sense of freshness, a reminder that there is a world out there beyond the one we know, a witness to the power of the church and the congregation to draw them back, and a testimony to the way the gospel continues to go out from this place to the very furthest corners of the earth. Give us an assurance that life goes on and is good, and the knowledge that our fellowship in you can never be broken, regardless of how far we roam or what we do or what would keep us away. Let the Spirit of Christ reign in our hearts today and make us glad together. And let your name be glorified in the renewal we experience. For you are our God, and we have never forgotten it. And it is in this wonderful name of your Son, Jesus, that we pray this to you, who taught all his disciples to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen.
Good morning, everybody. It's Dustin. I'm saying hi to you from Minecraft, here to give you a tour of what our church would look like in Minecraft to celebrate our 65th anniversary. So, why don't we head on inside? All right, this is the narthex, and you see over here we've got a closet, and over on the other side we have another closet. Hooray! Now, time to head into the sanctuary. Let's close the door behind us. Oh my, isn't that beautiful? It looks just like the real thing. You see some pews back here. Ooh, let's head on up to the sound booth and see what all of our sound people get to see every week. Ooh, cool. And over on the right, you see the handbell tables. Isn't that just lovely? All right, now let's take a look at all the pews. That's where all the people would sit if we could be in church. All right, now let's head on up to the altar and the pulpit where Pastor Jim would preach from. Let's head on up to the choir loft. All right, here we go. I sit right over here, and I think I have the best view in the house. Now, I had to use note blocks for the organ console. There's the choir pews and the organ pipes. All right, let's head back downstairs and see what else we can find. Oh, look, there's where Pastor Jim stores his robe. And in here we have the gathering room with a table and what's this? Ooh, a yummy cake made by one of our members. And in here's the counting room where they count all the money. And now let's see what everything looks like from outside. Just ignore the fact that we're in the desert. This is an alternate universe. All right, there's our beautiful church with the cross, and here's the roof. Well, while we're up here, we might as well say a prayer to help us celebrate 65 wonderful years of ministry. So let's pray. Lord, we thank you for all of the years that our church has been in service and ministry, and we hope for many more. Please be with all of our members and help keep them safe. And help us all to remember that the church is not the building. The church is the people. So help us to go and be the church in the world. All right. I'll see y'all later.
We now come to a time of the giving of our tithes, gifts, and offerings, and as we do so, we just extend our greatest thanks. Once again, it is because of you, the congregation, taking seriously your vows to this congregation as a member, that we are able to be in the financial place that we are and have been over the years. And so as we celebrate 65 years, we celebrate your generosity. We celebrate the fact that you love our congregation and are willing to give of your tithes, gifts, and offerings. And so we do so now. Let us pray. God of wisdom and all good gifts, we bring our tithes and offerings to your altar, remembering that, like Abraham, you have blessed us to be a blessing to others. Remind us this morning that the gift of freedom that comes to Christ is also a gift, not to be kept, but to be shared. Even as the world asserts that freedom is a ticket to go our own way, you made us free to be part of Christ's body in the world, connected and interdependent. May the way we live and the way we give reflect that kind of freedom. In Christ's blessed name we pray. Amen. Our wall of fame is made up of pastors of the past. They mark their tenure here, and today, as we look back on 65 years of ministry, we give thanks for those who have led us. These are the men and the women who have felt God's call into ministry, and through the grace of the cabinet and bishops, their ministry landed them here to tend this flock for a while. These are ministers who married us, baptized our children, and buried our family members. They were there on the worst days of our lives to offer us prayers. They were there on the best days of our lives to celebrate milestones. We have shared with these pastors our lives, and we give you thanks for their leadership and commitment to God's call on their life. And as we look back today
greetings
on 65...
to the people known as Mike Milford Hills United something. Methodist Church, I congratulate you on your milestone, your ministry milestone, your milestone of the presence in the Salisbury community for 65 years now. And I can relate to that as I'm also a 1955 model. So something special, as you know, about your congregation, your church family, and our family, the Kurtz family, was very privileged, very blessed to serve among you, with you. And we are grateful for that. Many memories, and I think of the relationships there, the rich relationships, thank you. And the ministry that was evidenced, for example, in Logos, that midweek children's and intergenerational ministry, the fruit that was born there, I still remember that and give thanks for that. The Milford Mills, the Thursday Night Live contemporary worship service, on and on. Just very grateful for who you are and the presence of Milford Hills in that community and beyond, representing Christ to so many. So we're grateful for the vibrancy and the Jesus-following spirit that's there with you now, and pray blessings now and for years to come. So again, congratulations on your 65th anniversary of ministry in the Salisbury area and beyond. Shalom. God bless. Thank you.
We thank these pastors for the ministry they have provided, for the dedication and many hours they have given of their lives, and for the ways they have made an impact on our life, and more importantly, our relationship with Jesus Christ. We celebrate today our homecoming, a time when we can look back at our past, for those who have led us and those who are currently leading us into the future. We thank you for the gifts that they have given and for the dedication they have to their call.
Good morning. I greet you in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Greetings to you on the 65th year of your ministry in Salisbury, North Carolina, as a community of faith. Gosh, that year was 1955, 65 years ago. I was 2 years old, and now I'm a retired United Methodist pastor, aging gracefully as you have done as a church and a community of faith. Thanks, Jim, for this time to reflect upon homecoming, and especially during this time in our lives, during this pandemic. I want you to celebrate, though. Celebrate your homecomings, your weddings, your celebrations of life, death, and resurrection, your choir or the sanctuary, pastors that have come in, Bible studies, Sunday school classes, barbecues, and baptisms. And do it in the next 65 years as a community built on faith. I join with Apostle Paul in his letter to the Ephesians, chapter 3, in a prayer for all believers. May you have strength for your souls, power in the Holy Spirit. May Christ dwell in your hearts through faith. Be grounded in love and stay in the fullness of our God. To God be the glory, Milford Hills United Methodist Church. Have a blessed day on this homecoming 2020. You have reason to celebrate, even if it's virtually. I'll continue to pray for you all.
We continue to pray for those who will be added to this wall, for those who God will send us to lead us and direct us into living out our mission to love, serve, and live as Christ.
Hello, my name is Laura Auten. I serve in the Uwori District as superintendent and missional strategist. It's good to be with you today as we come to God's Word and open it, and as we listen together for the voice and message of God. They built an altar to God and lived their whole lives in tents surrounded by flocks of animals. We remember how their faith and their faith alone drew them close to God. The scripture for today is the call of Abraham and Sarah to leave their country and their kindred. The scripture is Genesis 12, 1 through 9. Now the Lord said to Abram, "Go from your country and your kindred and your father's house to the land that I will show you. I will make of you a great nation, and I will bless you and make your name great so that you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and the one who curses you I will curse, and in you all the families of the earth shall be blessed." So Abram went, as the Lord had told him, and Lot went with him. Abram was 75 years old when he departed from Haran. Abram took his wife Sarah and his brother's son Lot, and all the possessions that they had gathered, and the persons whom they had acquired in Haran, and they set forth to go to the land of Canaan. When they had come to the land of Canaan, Abram passed through the land to the place at Shechem, to the oak of Moreh. At that time, the Canaanites were in the land. Then the Lord appeared to Abram and said, "To your offspring I will give this land." So he built there an altar to the Lord who had appeared to him. From there he moved on to the hill country on the east of Bethel and pitched his tent with Bethel on the west and Ai on the east. And there he built an altar to the Lord and invoked the name of the Lord. And Abram journeyed on by stages toward the Negev. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Join with me in prayer. Gracious Lord, we thank you for the gift of God's word. We pray that you will open our minds and our hearts so that we may hear and see and experience the word that you have for us this day. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. You may have heard this cute little story about the tourist who went too close to the edge of the Grand Canyon, lost her footing, and plunged over the side, clawing and scratching to try to save herself. As she went out of sight and just before she fell into space, she encountered a scrubby bush, which she desperately grabbed with both hands. Filled with terror, she called out toward heaven, "Is there anyone up there?" And this calm and powerful voice came out of the sky and said, "Yes, there is." And so the tourist pleaded, "Can you help me? Can you help me?" And the calm voice replied, "Yes, I probably can. What's your problem?" The tourist said, I fell over the cliff. I'm dangling in space and holding on to a bush that is about to let go. Please help me." And the voice from above, the calm voice said, "I'll try. Do you believe?" And she said, yes, I believe. And the calm voice said, "Do you have faith?" And she said, yes, I have strong faith. And so the calm voice said, "Well, in that case, simply let loose of the bush and everything will turn out fine." It was a tense pause. And then the tourist yelled, "Is there anyone else up there?" We might chuckle at that. But that is one of the messages of faith, and that is what it seems that Abraham and Sarah were asked to do. Let loose, let it go, and everything will turn out fine. It's a good way to describe the call of Abraham and Sarah to leave country and kindred. First of all, this was a call to travel. And as hard as that was, for Abraham's time, it was perhaps the easiest thing for him to do because he was used to traveling. His father had moved the family from Ur to Haran, and we read through the scripture of all the places where he went, following the Tigris and Euphrates River, traveling south through Galilee and Palestine, stopping at Shechem. Eventually, they continue south toward the Sinai Desert. You can trace all of that in the scriptures, and you can, and instead of me sounding like a travel log, you can trace this journey on the maps, those maps that are in the back of most Bibles. But that was the first part of the call. They were called to travel, to move, and to leave. Secondly, Abraham and Sarah were called to trust God's promises. The call to travel was hard, but the call to trust God's promises were perhaps even harder. We hear in the story that God called Abraham and Sarah, and he promised them land, children, and prominence. He says, leave your country and your kindred. That's the call to travel. And then he says, and I will make a great nation, and I will bless you and make your name great. Those are the promises. And within that, the call to trust those promises. Land and family would bring Abraham's family the things that people all over the world crave: well-being, security, prosperity, prominence. But if you're going to be a great nation, you need at the very least land and a lot of people. And so God promises land to a landless family and children to an old barren couple. It's clear that Abraham cannot provide these things for himself or his family. They are things that are promised and given by God. They are gifts. Abraham and Sarah were simply called to believe that God would do what he said he would do, that God would keep his word. They were called to trust God's promises. They received a call to travel, and they received a call to trust. Abraham and Sarah both had their moments when they failed to trust God and tried to give these gifts to themselves. They were not perfect and certainly had their flaws. Abraham tried to save his own skin by giving up Sarah to a foreign king. He doubts the angel who tells him that Sarah will bear a child. And Sarah gives Abraham her slave girl, Hagar, in order to rush the promise of children. We see here, and all through the Bible, that God uses flawed people to accomplish his purposes. So Abraham and Sarah were called to let loose of kin and kindred and trust God that everything would turn out fine. It boggles my mind to think that Abraham never saw the total fulfillment of the promise in his lifetime. He certainly enjoyed some of the gifts of the promises. He knew that his son Isaac was the child that God had promised, but it would take many, many generations for his people to become a great nation. He knew that Canaan was the land that God had promised, but it would be generations later until his family, his people, really settled and occupied the area. The reward for his obedience was the promise of a future, was a promise of something that would happen in the future, the hope of a future that he would never see. Can you imagine? It's like laying down your money for something that you personally will never receive. Let loose of your life. Lay down your nets. Those who lose their lives for my sake will find their life. Faith is the ability to embrace the future that God has in store with such dedication and passion that one can let loose of the present for the sake of the future. Faith is believing in the future and the will of God that God has in store for us, the plans that God has for us and for our children or for our church, for our community. believing enough to know that our future is never, that our future is more important than our past or even our present, which are both very important things. All through the Bible, we learn that what will be is more important than what has been or what is. What can and will be is important enough to lay down our lives. You may remember from the Gospels the conversation that Jesus had with some unnamed folks as he was going along the road. We never learned their names. One person said to him, "I'll follow you wherever you go, Jesus." And so Jesus reminds this person that foxes have holes, birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head. And Jesus summons a second person to follow, and their response is, "Well, let me go bury my father." And Jesus says, "Let the dead bury the dead, but you go to proclaim the kingdom of God." And Jesus summons a third person to follow, and their response is, "Let me say farewell to those at my home." And Jesus says, "No one who puts a hand to the plow and looks back is fit for the kingdom of God." The summons, the call, the tugging at the heart to follow Jesus, to be a part of the kingdom, is one that is urgent and it is immediate. And when accepted, is eternal and life-transforming. Even the most precious things to us, our families, our homes, country and kindred, even our memory and preservation of the past cannot delay us or prevent us from walking with Jesus wherever he would have us go. Some of you may be listening to this message while you are celebrating homecoming, a time to remember the many people who came before us, who are like Abraham and Sarah, who may not have lived to see the earthly rewards of their obedience to God's promise, but they put their hand to the plow and they did not look back. They were faithful to God's will. Their reward was eternal. I'm reminded of Hebrews chapter 11, verse 13. "All of these died in faith without having received the promises, but from a distance they saw and greeted them." Homecoming is the time to remember those who have seen the promises of God from a distance, those who have greeted those promises and have been faithful to them and sacrificed for them. It's also a time to remember that the same call comes to each of us. Years from now, the seeds that we have planted today will be blooming. The rewards of your obedience and your sacrifice will be present. Years from now, at some future homecoming, people will talk about how those people endured a global pandemic, a global recession, and a world wounded by the sin of racism. And through trusting in God's promises and God's presence, they were able to continue as faithful and loving witnesses in the midst of a fractured world. They were able to understand anew the depth of connection. They were able to understand in new ways what it meant to be the church. And they were able to let loose of pride and privilege and were able to be instruments of healing and justice. As all of us respond to God's call to follow Christ Jesus, we pick up our staff and pack up our tent and we go on teaching and preaching and witnessing and praying and giving and helping, because God's future and God's plan are much more important than the past, and even more important than what is now. We learn from the past, we value the past, and we live in the present. But we let go, knowing and trusting that everything will be fine, because we trust in a God who keeps his promises. Let us pray. God of power and might, I give you thanks for the heritage of faith in this place, and for the ones that through the years you have graced and strengthened to be obedient and sacrificial. I thank you for the words on the plaque that we made in Sunday school many years ago that says following means faith, stepping out on it. Following means loving, enough to leave everything behind, enough to be a servant to others. Dear God, give us faith and give us strength to follow you. Amen. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
And now hear this benediction. Go out into the world so that we as a congregation can be the body of Christ, and so that the God that we worship, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, can be felt as we go out into the world to greet others and to love others as God loves us. Go in peace. Amen.
Blessed be the time.